next on CTN News.
It's been going along very well. So that's really a tribute to everybody that helped me, and it was there, the doctors and everybody else.
The response to a life or death situation earned them recognition by the city of Coon Rapids and much more. Plus, a new vendor has been selected to take over the food and beverage operations at the Harvest Grill at Bunker Hills. But first,
part of the question was to council, is this something that you think you want to consider, or should we really not even have this discussion?
A proposal that would move the Salvation Army's residential rehab center to Coon Rapids. That top CTN News this Friday, October 24th, 2014.
Thanks for joining us. After more than 50 years at its current site in North Minneapolis, the Salvation Army wants to move further north.
Officials say they've outgrown their current space and need to move due to aging infrastructure. So this week, the organization presented a plan and drawing for a new facility to the Coon Rapids City Council. CTN's Bao Vang has the details.
The Salvation Army wants to move its adult rehabilitation center from its current location in Minneapolis to here, a never-before-developed site in Coon Rapids. It wants to build a 107,000 square foot building on the corner of Val Street and Coon Rapids Boulevard.
The facility is extremely old, and there are some issues that I think are just going to cost a great deal of money to fix.
Instead, a brand new facility would sit on this 5.1-acre lot and accommodate the wide uses required for the ARC program to provide spiritual, emotional, and social support for people recovering from drug and alcohol addiction. The proposal includes building a warehouse to process and sort donations. Also, classrooms, dining halls, and a chapel will be on site. Plus, there will be housing for about 100 people.
We're not a homeless shelter. We do have, some of our guys would fit into the homeless category, but we're not a homeless shelter per se.
The Salvation Army representatives presented its plan to council members this week, who discussed it for only about 30 minutes. Coon Rapids Community Development Director Mark Novinsky says one of the challenges is the proposed site is zoned for industrial use, and the housing facility would not fall under that. Although he says a city council has discretion to make exceptions.
Their conclusion really was that they weren't necessarily for it, they weren't necessarily against it, but they want to continue discussions and try to learn more and understand if that's a good fit for the site.
The Salvation Army, meanwhile, is staying optimistic.
We feel very confident about it. We hope that it'll work out in our favor, and we'll see what happens.
Bao Vang, CTN News.
The Salvation Army says traffic would be mostly limited to staff and a resident manager who would be on site 24 hours a day. The City Council plans to discuss the proposal further over the next month.
A home declared hazardous by the city must be repaired or it will be torn down. On Tuesday night, the City Council took formal action against the property located at 9910 Lynette Street. Inspections have found excessive clutter, creating a safety hazard, as well as boarded up windows, a leaky roof, and rotted front door. The home has been burglarized twice in recent years. If the home is not brought into compliance, it will be torn down at a cost of $15,000.
If you drove past Coon Rapids High School this week, things probably looked a little different on Northdale Boulevard. The county, city, and school district conducted a test on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday with cones and barrels. School officials are hoping to eventually make improvements to Northdale Boulevard to channelize traffic better with turn lanes and improve pedestrian safety for students crossing the busy roadway. There are still many questions to be worked out if permanent improvements are made, including who would pay for the project and who would maintain the landscaped median. Work is wrapping up on a major reconstruction project on Round Lake Boulevard. Crews have been working much of the week to get the final paving done between 119th Avenue and Main Street. Once that's completed, the lanes will be striped. Round Lake Boulevard is expected to reopen to traffic by the end of October. And by the end of November, a new traffic light will be installed at Wedgwood Drive.
We now know who will be taking over the food and beverage operations at Bunker Hills next month. This week, the City Council entered into a memorandum of understanding with the Morrissey Hospitality Companies, which is based in St. Paul. The company, which currently employs around 1,000 people, manages a number of restaurant and catering facilities in the Twin Cities, including the St. Paul Grill.
We are so excited about this, I can't tell you. We've been working night and day since preparing that. Hopefully we'll get the nod tonight. We are prepared to step in at a moment's notice and make sure that there's the least amount of interruption to this change as possible.
A panel interviewed a total of 5 vendors before selecting Morrissey Hospitality, which will take over the operations at the Harvest Grill on November 3rd. The current owner is in default of its lease and owes the city more than $78,000. You may soon not have to make a run for the Coon Rapids Anoka border if you're craving Taco Bell. The owners of the Gateway Commerce Center are hoping to get an amendment to the planned unit development passed to allow a restaurant with drive-through instead of a bank. Taco Bell wants to open a new restaurant near the new McDonald's at Highway 10 and Hanson Boulevard. No word yet if the Taco Bell on Round Lake Boulevard will remain open. Well, in August, we told you about a Coon Rapids man who survived a sudden cardiac arrest that was caught on tape during a summer concert at the dam.
The quick action of strangers giving CPR and using an AED revived Tim Buck's heart. Since then, Buck has been going to cardiac rehab every week, never knowing the faces of those who gave him another chance at life until now. CTN's Joe Nelson reports.
It's kind of a interesting thing that's going to happen.
On Tuesday, Tim Buck, along with his wife Fatima of Coon Rapids, walked to his car and drove across town.
I think this is a very important day, and I've been looking forward to it.
Waiting to see him were Chris Shields, Ryan Radke, and Mark Snell, three strangers who met Tim once before.
At the Coon Rapids Dam, I was dancing quite vigorously, you know, and then suddenly I started feeling pain in my, you know, my chest. And that was the last thing I knew that happened, and I was gone.
I knew he needed help, and I jumped in, checked his pulse, no pulse, and I started CPR. And
I grabbed an AED out of my vehicle, and I saw Tim lying there. So I gave it to my coworker. She strapped it on.
Began doing heavy compressions, and just there on and there on until emergency services showed up.
Their quick actions, along with a few others, got Tim Buck's heart beating again after he suffered sudden cardiac arrest on the dance floor. After a quadruple bypass surgery the next day, Tim began his recovery process, never knowing those who gave him another chance at life.
No, I haven't talked to one of them yet.
Nearly 3 months after Tim clinically died and was brought back, he finally got a chance to meet his team of rescuers.
Thank you very much. Oh, my God, thank you.
Good to see you standing.
Introduce yourself.
What's your name?
Brian.
Brian?
Yep.
Brian is one of the guys doing CPR on you.
Oh my God.
Wow.
Thank you. You're the first one, right?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
The rescuers were honored by the Coon Rapids City Council this week for their quick actions that day.
I just appreciate each and every one of them, and I thank them from the bottom of my heart for what they did.
The Buck family and the responders say they hope everyone can learn from this successful outcome.
Everybody should be trained in first aid and CPR. I think it's a definite must.
And have defibrillators around and stuff, and know that this is going to really help save lives.
Two of the rescuers were trained through HeartSafe Coon Rapids, a program led by Officer Brian Plotz, to get people trained in CPR and to get AEDs out in the community. We'll have an extended version of this story in December's edition of Community Close-Up. And if you'd like to help the Buck family with high medical expenses, a benefit has been set up. For more information, go to our website at ctnstudios.com. Stephen Karen.
All right, great story. I hope to see many more of these things in the future.
Very
thanks.
Good. Thank you.
Still to come on CTN News, the city's community development director says goodbye.
Plus, the Nucleus Clinic hosts its fall fundraiser. Also ahead, state officials run a mock exercise on what they do in the event of a patient diagnosed with Ebola in Minnesota.
The Vikings have always tried to help the kids here in Minnesota.
And some local amateur football players meet the pros at a special camp this week. We'll take you there coming up. The U.S. government is preparing Ebola response squads, which are being likened to public health SWAT teams.
This after being criticized about the federal government's handling of Eric Duncan, the first person diagnosed with Ebola in the U.S. Locally, officials here in Minnesota conducted a tabletop exercise on Thursday to review the state's response to a potential case of Ebola. More than 100 representatives took part. They walked through a mock scenario and applied the state's Ebola response plan. The Minnesota Department of Health has also set up an information line for Ebola questions. That number is 651-201-3920. It is staffed Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. And Saturday night, an information session on Ebola will take place at North Hennepin Community College in Brooklyn Park. The meeting will run from 6 to 8 p.m. Panel members will present facts and related concerns about Ebola and answer questions from the audience.
Supporters of Anoka County's only nonprofit reproductive health clinic gathered this week for the annual fall fundraiser.
Dozens of people turned out at the Nucleus Clinic Thursday night for the Wine, Salad, and Chocolate Open House and Benefit. The clinic, founded in 1971, serves approximately 1,000 uninsured or underinsured patients. Even with the implementation of the Affordable Care Act, some people are still having trouble meeting their deductibles. Clinic staff say the Nucleus Clinic is a great option for those people who need routine reproductive health care.
Schools in the Minnesota State Colleges and Universities system are soliciting input from their public about their future. Next Monday, Anoka Ramsey Community College will be hosting a Charting the Future meeting in the Legacy Room from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Implementation teams will share their work to date, share insights from their research, test initiative ideas, and gather feedback. The work is based on 6 recommendations developed by students, staff, and faculty, and approved by the MinSCU Board of Trustees last November.
A man who we heard from earlier in this newscast gave his last interview as Community Development Director this week. On Thursday, city staff held a going-away party for Mark Novinsky, who is leaving the city after 13 years of service. Novinsky started as Redevelopment Specialist in 2001 and was promoted to Community Development Director in 2005. He's worked on a lot of projects over the years, including the redevelopment of Coon Rapids Boulevard.
I'm a little sad, I'm a little torn about leaving because there are some great projects in the works. As I mentioned, you know, I think Port Riverwalk is, the market's really coming back, and that area is going to continue to be attractive because of its proximity to 610 and also its ability to fill some housing needs for seniors and other people wanting to move into the community.
He's also excited about development planned around the North Star Station and the Foley Park and Ride lot. Novinsky will start a new job as Physical Development Director for the City of Golden Valley on Monday, and we wish him all the best.
The Coon Rapids Athletic Association and the Minnesota Vikings teamed up this week to bring a mini camp to Coon Rapids. Several current and former Vikings players, including linebacker Matt Blair, came out to inspire youth football players in the city. High school varsity players also helped run the kids through 8 different stations. The drills were designed to improve their football skills.
But Vikings have always tried to help the kids here in Minnesota, and it's a good thing. I mean, if you don't understand how to do it as a kid, and you get taught by maybe one of the professional guys, you move in the right direction.
I think the station over there where you hit the dummies away and then you tackle was the most fun.
You had to like run through these tires and you had to get through the dummies and stuff.
I like the long snapping station because I also play long snapper. So that's probably my favorite.
The event ended with Vikings legend number 44, Chuck Foreman, presenting the Coach's Sportsmanship Award to CRAA coach Joel Height. Former linebacker E.J. Henderson also presented a Vikings team jersey to Easton Sorensen, the Coon Rapids High School player sidelined by a rare brain disorder earlier this fall.
Keanu Reeves stars in his first action movie since The Matrix. Howie Shapiro has a preview of that and more in this week's Now Showing.
Jonathan, you got out once. You dip so much as a pinky back into this pond, you may find something reaching out to pull you back in.
It's personal.
Where'd you get that car?
What does it matter?
It's not what you did, son. It's who you did it to.
The nobody?
That nobody. It's John Wick.
John Wick. An ex-hitman comes out of retirement to track down the gangsters that took everything from him.
People keep asking if I'm back. Yeah, I'm thinking I'm back.
Calm down. It's an old house.
This is a joke. Come on, you guys. Who's doing that? Sarah, cut it out.
I'm not pushing it.
Just spelled hi, friend.
Hey, this is freaking me out. I'm done with this.
Ouija. A group of friends must confront their most terrifying fears when they awaken the dark powers of an ancient spirit board.
Did you kill Debbie? We're done. We're not playing anymore.
It's not even real, okay?
It's just a game.
I'm Howie Shapiro, and that's what's showing.
All right, not the horror flick.
Well, if you're not doing that, maybe you're doing your leaves. Either way, have a great weekend. We'll see you next time.